So exam two for the night class is Monday, the 14th. And for the day class is Tuesday, the 15th. And I guess at this point, let's just for topics, let's just do vectors. And 2D kinematics. And so the stuff that we're going to get to today, that'll have to be on the next exam. Problem set one, we haven't had a problem set yet. I'll post it next week. I'll post it by the time of the exam. And it'll be that discussion thing that I talked about for how these are going to be graded, the discussion of the problem sets. For the grade on it will be the next week in lab. So I guess that would be the 10/21 to 10/23 are when those labs are for this class. When I post it, I'll put a news item in D2L about it. So it should be pretty obvious when it's up there. And it's just gonna it's gonna combine a few of the things that we've done. Thinking about stuff in 1D, thinking about stuff in 2D, some of the stuff that we're going to get into now with kinetics will be on it. We're about to start the new topic. Does anyone have any questions about 2D kinematics or vectors before I go on? Okay. The next topic is kinetics of particles. In 2D. Kinetics, well, let me say kinematics, the stuff that we've been doing up until now, is describing motion. You can also think of it as relationships between quantities that can be observed on a video camera. Those quantities are position, velocity, acceleration, and time. Okay? Like you can measure where something's going on a video camera. You can use a stopwatch and figure out elapsed times. But now that we're going on to kinetics, we're going to be talking about quantities that you can't get off of video. So kinetics. Combines the kinematic quantities with two new ones. Those are mass and force. And when you're doing kinetics, you're doing calculations related to like the causes of the motion, not just describing the relationships, but you're figuring out what's causing this motion in the first place. I don't know why they make those words so similar. It seems unnecessarily confusing, but if you want a way to remember it, think kinematics is the easier one. So that's the stuff that your ma could do. Kinetics is the harder one, you know? Ma. Love you, ma. One thing I wanted to say about these. Mass is going to be a scalar quantity. Force is a vector quantity, though, which means that force has direction. And so the behavior is different if you apply, as you know, the behavior of an object is different if you apply a force this direction than if you apply a force this direction. And the fact that it's a vector lets us deal with that directional nature. So first, let's talk about what mass is. Mass is a measure of an object's resistance to acceleration. So let's say it measures how much an object resists acceleration. So for example, this is, I don't know, that's a horrible semi-truck. Anyways, so say you have a semi-truck going this way and a smart going the other way. You know that if these two collide, it's going to be really bad for the smart, right? And the semi might not even notice it if he's not paying attention. And the reason is when those hit, think of acceleration as a change in velocity, right? They're going to hit. The semi has a very high mass. It has a very strong resistance to being accelerated. And so this collision is going to accelerate it very little. After the collision, it's going to have a velocity that's not that much similar, not that much different than its velocity before the collision. You know, it's just going to have a smart car stuck to its grill. The smart doesn't have a high resistance to acceleration. It doesn't have a big mass. And so its velocity is going to change drastically. Okay, so that's what I mean by something that has a high mass has a high resistance to acceleration. Something with a low mass has a low resistance to acceleration. The SI units for mass are kilograms. So that's something to sort of notice. You might think SI units would be grams, not the one with a prefix, you know, but it's kilograms is the SI unit. And we're sort of used to, just because from like the buttons on your bathroom scale or whatever, we're used to thinking of kilograms as being converted to pounds if you go from one type of units to another. But actually pounds are a measure of a totally different thing. Pounds are actually a measure of force. Kilograms are a measure of mass. So really a true conversion from SI units to imperial units or American units or whatever you want to call them is kilograms to slugs. That's slugs is the mass unit in the imperial system. So what does it mean that you have a, you know, that a scale has a setting for kilograms and a scale for pounds? They're not measuring the same thing. It means that your scale is assuming that you're taking your measurement on Earth, where it knows the acceleration of gravity, and it can combine it all to make them equal. But if you used your bathroom scale, so what the bathroom scale actually measures is a force, actually, and it's assuming that it knows the acceleration of gravity to tell you what the mass is. But if you used a bathroom scale to measure your mass on the moon, it would be totally wrong about your mass. It would still be right about the amount of force you applied to it, because that's what it's measuring. Anybody have any idea? So to relate, okay, to use a bathroom scale to measure your mass, there needs to be gravity. And it needs to know what that gravity is. You know, that needs to be wired into it in order to tell you what the mass is. And mass for people, you know, on space trips, on the space shuttle or whatever, mass is a really important thing to know about yourself, because you lose muscle mass really fast, because none of your activities are load bearing because there's no gravity. And so it's really important that they have accurate ways to measure their mass, but you can't use a bathroom scale because there's no gravity. So you get on a bathroom scale, it says you weigh zero. So getting back to what mass really is, a resistance to acceleration, anybody happen to know how they measure your mass on the space shuttle where there's no gravity? They put you in a harness and they shake you with this machine, and they measure how much they accelerate you with a known set of forces that they're applying. Basically, they measure your resistance to acceleration. And so that's how they know whether your muscles are atrophying too much or you know, you're staying at an appropriate weight. Resistance to acceleration. Yep. The Thighmaster. That's only one muscle, just your inner thigh muscles, but still, that's better than nothing. I don't know. I mean, actually, you do?
I did some observation hours at a PT department out in Burnsville, part of the Courage Center. And what they're doing with the little kids who have various spastic disorders, they'll come in, they either can't hold themselves up or they'll crawl or they come in a wheelchair. They put them in a suit, and there's all these like rubber bands that, and the PT knows which ones to connect to which mm-hmm. ones depending on where the spasticity and the flaccid muscle
yeah.
are. And those kids get, I mean, it takes a while to get them set up and then they can walk.
Huh.
It's amazing.
Yeah, wow.
So it's these bands that are tugging.
And so, like, in outer space, they put them in these suits that...
The relationship here is that this came from NASA.
Oh, okay, huh.
Technology from space.
Uh-huh. Sort of in the opposite.
Yeah.
So instead of...
It's related to whatever they're using.
Uh-huh. Huh. Oh, that's interesting. So, yeah. Fancy suits is the answer. And mass, I mean, it makes sense that that's not a vector quantity. It's also only positive. You can't have a negative mass. Although, when you get into weird modern physics, there is sort of negative mass. But we're not going to deal with anything like that. And the other new quantity is force. Force is a vector quantity, so it does have direction. You can think of force as a measure of the intensity of a push or pull on an object. And one of the things, it seems like nothing about it when you first start thinking about forces seems like this is going to be a big issue. But this is something to keep your eye on as we go through this. The fact that we're always going to be talking about a force on an object that we specify, as opposed to just like being this force that sort of lives on its out there in the world on its own, like it does in Star Wars. This is different. We're, in order to put numbers to forces, we're always going to be have to be really clear to ourselves about what the chosen object is that we want to measure the force on. Okay, so like a baseball hits a bat hits a baseball. What's the force? Well, the answer is different depending on whether you're talking about the force the ball applies to the bat, where the bat is your chosen object, or whether you're talking about the force applied to the ball, where the ball is your chosen object. And so I'm gonna, you know, it's gonna get super annoying. Maybe it already is, like how I'm gonna keep like saying, like, I want you to be very clear to yourself when you're talking about these things, like what is the chosen object? But if you do that, it's gonna help you in the long run. If you always think about like, it's you're not just talking about a force, you're talking about a force on a chosen object. And what is that object? The SI units of force. Are the kilogram meter per second squared. That's sort of a surprisingly complicated, what? Also known as the Newton. So yeah, it's a sort of a surprisingly complicated combination of our fundamental units. I mentioned early on that any physics unit that we're gonna deal with all semester is a combination of a measure of mass, a measure of length, and a measure of time. But since we use force, since it's such a fundamental physical quantity, they give this jumble of units its own name, the Newton, and you represent it with a capital N. In this class, there are only going to be two sources of force on an object. On the chosen object. The first is gravity. And the force that gravity applies to an object is called the weight. And the second is contact with another object. And so this is going to be this fact that there are only two sources of force in this whole class are going to be a nice sort of simplifying, like grounding fact when things get complicated and you start to sort of, you look at a problem and you're like, oh my God, like there's too many things going on. What you need to remember is just, okay, gravity is applying a force to the chosen object. And then I'm just gonna think about the outside of the boundary and where are other things touching. And if you do that, it's a lot easier to keep track of what the forces are, okay? So the benefit of this is it's sort of simple. It's a simple way to remember how to approach a complicated, you know, problem. In order to express force vectors numerically to put numbers on these forces. You need a coordinate system. And if you've been going through those vector practice problems, you see how those numbers just change fundamentally if you change the coordinate system. And not all coordinate systems are acceptable for us. And so that's the next kind of big thing I want to talk about. What coordinate systems are okay? We'll only use what are called inertial coordinate systems. And that is just a name someone made up for a coordinate system that has two properties. An inertial coordinate system doesn't have has an origin that's not accelerating. And its other property is that the coordinate system axes are not rotating. If you have a coordinate system with these properties, so in an inertial coordinate system, forces obey what's called Newton's second law. I'll just abbreviate that N2L. This is the most important equation in this whole semester. It's a relationship between the motion of an object and the force that's applied to an object. And Newton's second law says, in an inertial coordinate system, the net force vector on an object is equal to the mass of the object times the acceleration vector of the object. We'll call it, write little blurbs down here. So we'll call this equation one. So F net here is the sum of forces acting on the chosen object M is the mass of the chosen object. And A is the acceleration of the chosen object. Yes. All right. So I want to try to give a little, mostly I think good intuition about this comes from just doing a bunch of problems and sort of seeing how it all works. But I think I can help you sort of get started in the right direction with how to think about inertial coordinate systems, how to think about the relationship between whether these laws of physics hold or whether they don't. You know, this law does not hold if you're in a non-inertial coordinate system. So here is sort of an intuitive way to think about a coordinate system. Think of a coordinate system as a video camera. Then the position, velocity, acceleration, and time are the values that you would measure by looking at the video. As long as that video camera, and there are ways of measuring forces too, like a bathroom scale is one, but you know, there are ways of, you know, more accurate and also more intricate ways of measuring the forces between objects. And if you took a video camera and put it on the back of a car that was moving with a constant velocity vector, okay, so in other words, you fixed a video camera to a car and the car drove away, but it kept going in a straight line and its speed wasn't changing, constant velocity vector. You can think of that as like the video camera is a coordinate system that's not accelerating. Its origin isn't accelerating. And it also isn't rotating, okay? So that video camera, what you see in that video camera is an inertial coordinate system. And so if you measured the acceleration that you saw in that camera, even though the camera's moving, and compared it to forces that were measured, you'd see that those accelerations and those forces related to each other through Newton's second law. Newton's second law holds, okay? As long as that velocity stays constant. But if instead you put that video camera on a car that was accelerating, or you put that video camera on something that was rotating, and you measured the accelerations from that video and compared it to forces that were measured, you'd see that Newton's second law was violated. That equation would not hold, okay? And it turns out that, you know, since whatever, we have to be able to chase muskrats and stuff for dinner, we have to have some sort of sense of physics going on in our head to be able to jump over things and whatever. We kind of have a sense of what we expect, the physics we expect to happen, you know. And we expect things to happen. We expect our viewpoint, like our video camera, our eyes or whatever, to happen in an inertial coordinate system. And so if we're accelerating, it looks to us like things are happening that kind of defy our sense of the way physics should work, you know? Like we kind of have a Newton's second law thing going on in our heads. You know, we're always sort of calculating. So anyways, if we see videos that are taken with a non-inertial coordinate system, a video that's taken where the origin is accelerating or the video camera is rotating, it looks to us like something's off, okay? So I wanted to show a couple of videos to kind of relate this sense of like, whether it looks like physics is doing the right things, are things behaving the way they should, and relate that to the coordinate system being inertial or non-inertial, okay? Like this idea, it seems, okay, we're in one of those situations where, like, I know I haven't said it very clearly, so I keep talking and it just makes it more confusing. But basically, like, this relationship between inertial coordinate systems and Newton's second law, that feels like sort of an abstract thing, an abstract mathematical thing, but it's closely connected to something that's not abstract. And that is our sense of looking at something, whether it makes sense or it looks off, okay, or it looks weird. And that's what these videos are sort of meant to get at. So let's see. No, that's actually because you're slashing your brain around. that is even, no, that's something different. Because the weird stuff that happens with relativity happens even at a constant velocity. That doesn't take accelerations, it just takes a really high speed. Okay, so let me take this off mute. It's better if you can hear it. Anyone want to just say what? It's Jamiroquai, yeah. From like, so I said in the day class, this was like around 1995, and in the back was like, good song. I guess the idea of this, though, without the music, like, if you've noticed, besides the bugs and stuff, some weird stuff seems to be going on. Some stuff that it looks like, you look at it physically, you know, like, you know Newton's second law to know, like, something weird with the physics in this video. It's so much more enjoyable with the music. But what's here? Making and so tell something going on. You could say it looks like acceleration going on that appear to by forces. Okay, that's what your brain is telling you. The relate between acceleration doesn't look right. You think of the system, the video camera, as like video camera is fixed on the floor and he's sliding around the video camera. And they have a floor with the video camera mounted on the wall and building. Around while he dances, you know? And so the walls are moving around with him. So you're watching this through a non-inertial coordinate system. And the effect of it is that the force is on his feet, and then using video or accelerations. Balls. In a ceiling. Slide around, and the camera is on the, it's like let's see, so they have this little fake room with a video camera mounted, and it doesn't have a floor, and so he stands in one place on the floor dancing while they slide everything else around him.
Oh, okay.
And it's a really cool effect. Apparently they made this video that won like every MTV video award that year. They made it in like 2 hours, and like some of the stuff that happened, like that blood was supposed to come out of something else, but they're just like, ah, who cares, you know? They just started it and wrapped it in like 2 hours, but it's a really cool effect. And then I wanted to show this other video. It's long. It's kind of for the same reason. Let's see. Awkward school bus levitation. You have to, it's very fast. You miss it if you blink. But it just looks like out of the blue. And then she looks funny because she's embarrassed. It's like out of the blue with no force applied or anything. She just shoots up to the ceiling, you know? That only can happen because the video camera is being held on the bus. It accelerates with the bus, and so weird stuff happens in there, you know? Okay, so remember those two videos if you ever like are trying to wrap your head around this inertial, non-inertial coordinate system thing. Those are sort of the key to understanding understanding the relationship between this law of physics and the restrictions on the coordinate system. And remember to think of a coordinate system as essentially a video camera, you know. Any questions about that? All right, well, here's the first mathematical question about forces. What force does gravity apply to an object? Well, we're going to make the assumption that gravity, however hard it pulls on an object, it pulls on that object with that force, no matter what the object's doing. So whether it's rolling or, you know, standing still or accelerating or whatever, we're going to assume that the force that gravity applies doesn't change. That seems sort of reasonable. So the way we're going to answer this question is we're going to think of objects in free fall. And the reason we're going to think about objects in free fall is because we know the acceleration of objects in free fall. Okay? So their acceleration is 9.81 meters per second squared down. Okay, so first, let's say we're talking about our chosen object, let's say is a 1 kilogram object. In free fall, we know that the only force is gravity. Or the only force is the weight of the object. So Newton's second law says the force vector that gravity applies to the object. And now I'm just writing down Newton's second law. All the forces, right? Newton's second law says take all the forces and add them together. Well, there's only one force here when it's in free fall. That's the weight. Is equal to the mass of the chosen object. What's that? 1 kilogram, yep. Times the acceleration vector. And if we have our y-axis pointing up, what's the acceleration vector of the object in free fall? Yep. And so do this multiplication, and we get a force vector of 0, -9.81 kilograms times meters per second squared is newtons. Okay? Okay. So this is you. You're all, maybe gravity applies a force of 1 newton down to every object. So that's a hypothesis. So let's think about an object in free fall that has a different mass, okay? So try a chosen object with a mass of 100 kilograms, okay? So Newton's second law in this case says add up all the forces acting on the chosen object. Again, that's only gravity. So the weight force, the force of gravity, is equal to the mass of the chosen object. What is it? 100 kilograms times the acceleration. What's the acceleration? Yep, it's still the same. The acceleration, no matter what the mass is, the acceleration in free fall is the same. So 100 times 0, -9.81 meters per second squared. And so we get a force applied by gravity of 0x, -981 newtons. Okay? So, gravity doesn't apply the same force to every object. Instead, it applies a force of mg acting down where m is the object's mass. And G is 9.81 meters per second squared. Well, the negative refers to the down. So if we're just talking about everything being down, then we just leave it positive. So here's something to notice. It seems a little weird, but first, gravity pulls on objects with different forces. But all objects have the same acceleration during free fall. So if you dropped, so let's forget about air resistance. Say you dropped one of those pinballs that we used in lab last week, and you dropped the bowling ball from the top of a building, you know? Which one would hit the ground first? It would be the same. The acceleration's the same. So at each step, you know, their velocities would be increasing the same amount. They'd hit the ground at the same time. So that's the same. But what about the force that gravity is applying? Which one is gravity applying the same or different forces to those? It's applying different forces. It's applying a way bigger force to the bowling ball than it is to the pinball, okay? That's sort of an odd difference between acceleration and force, but that's the way it is. Isn't exactly saying that, but so it's not exactly that, but it's sort of related. So it would hit the ground harder, apply a bigger force to the ground because the bowling ball having a bigger mass is much more resistant to acceleration, and stopping something is an acceleration, you know? So the ground doesn't have to apply that much force to accelerate the pinball, but it has to apply a big force to accelerate the bowling ball. Okay, let's do another example. We're just going to sort of keep working up. So we'll think of it now as like, now we've figured out by thinking about a free fall example how much force gravity applies to things. So now let's think of an example where there's a person standing on a scale not very happy with the results. And we want to know what force vector is applied to a 50 kilogram person by the scale. And we'll use the same, you know, standard coordinate system with the y-axis pointing up. We're going to use Newton's second law again, but it's one step more complicated now because there are two forces acting on the person now. I said that there are only two types of forces that we'll deal with in this whole class. One is weight, the force applied by gravity, and one is the force applied by objects touching the chosen object. Well, there are two forces on the person. The weight and the force applied by the scale. And so Newton's second law now says we're going to add up those two force. Question? They have to be equal and opposite in this case, just because he's not accelerating, but I think it might not be exactly the reason that you're thinking of. So we'll talk about that pretty soon. But Newton's second law says, take each force that's acting. In this case, there's going to be two force vectors, add them up, and those have to be equal to his mass times his acceleration. We know the force that gravity is applying. We just figured that out, right? So the force applied by gravity is zero and then negative 50 times 9.81 or negative 490.5 newtons. That's the force applied to the person by gravity. And then the second force is the force applied to the person by the scale. And if you add these two together, that has to be equal to his mass, 50 kilograms, times his acceleration. What's his acceleration in this case? It's zero. He's just standing there. He's not in free fall. So zero. Zero. And so this says that zero, negative 490.5 plus the force vector applied by the scale is equal to zero, zero. And so we can add zero, negative 490. Well, we can add zero, positive 490 to both sides. And we get that the force applied by the scale is equal to zero positive 490.5 newtons. Okay, so gravity was applying a force of 490.5 newtons down. And in order to keep him from accelerating down, the scale had to apply a force of 490.5 newtons up to counteract that. Any questions about that? That's because from this example, where we're sort of reasoning through what the force is applied by gravity, we figured out that gravity always applies a force down. And since our y-axis is up, gravity always applies a force in the negative y-direction.
And what numbers did you multiply to get the four?
His mass, 50 kilograms times 9.81. Any other questions about that? Okay, let's do one more similar example. So now let's say that the same person is still standing on a scale, but now the scale's in an elevator. I think he has scoliosis. And let's say that the elevator and not just the elevator, we're also talking about the scale and the person. Say they're all accelerating down at 1 meter per second squared. What's the force vector? Applied to that same 50 kilogram person by the scale. Well, Newton's second law again says we can add up all the forces acting on the person, and they have to add up to being equal to the mass times the acceleration. So we have the weight force, 0, -490.5. And the only other force acting on the person is the force applied by the scale. So call that force vector scale. And that has to be equal to his mass times his acceleration. What's his acceleration in this problem? It's down though, so it's -1, but yep, 0, -1. And so you can write that as 0, -490.5 plus F scale is equal to 0, -50. And now add 0, +490 to both sides, and you get that F scale, the force applied to him by the scale, is equal to 0, 440.5 newtons. Okay, so what we're talking about here, this force that the scale applies to the person, is actually what like a bathroom scale measures. It doesn't have any way of directly measuring the force that gravity applies to, even though that's what you sort of want to know, right? What it's really measuring is the force that the scale is applying to your feet, right? That's what it can measure. And so in this first example, if you're not accelerating, the force that the scale measures and reads out on the display is exactly your weight. It's exactly the force that gravity is applying to you. In this second example, where you're in an elevator accelerating down, the force that the scale applies to you is not exactly equal to the force that gravity applies to you. It reads a little bit smaller. And you could actually, you know, take a bathroom scale on the elevator. The elevator, most of the time it's moving, isn't accelerating. So remember that. It's really only accelerating when it starts moving and getting up to speed. But for that little moment, and you can feel it in your stomach, you know, when it happens, like you can feel yourself, something weird is happening. The bathroom scale, if you're going down, will actually read a smaller value. And this is why. This is how you know that that'll be the case. And so what would happen if the elevator was accelerating up? It would read higher, yeah. And you can feel that in your legs if you're on an elevator that accelerates very quickly and it starts to go up. You can feel your legs start to sort of, like, you can feel that there's more force on your legs. It's that same effect. No, it just has to do with the acceleration. There's a different effect of gravity based on how far you are from the center of the Earth, but the difference between even the basement and the 100th floor isn't even enough to be measurable. The difference between sea level and the top of Mount Everest even is almost immeasurable. It's like the difference between 9.806 for G at sea level and I think 9.804 at the top of Mount Everest.
Is this an example of negative Gs, like they do in aircraft?
I don't know what they call positive and negative, but yeah, that acceleration of 9.81, that's what they call 1G. And so like a fighter pilot,
like the top of a roller coaster.
Right. What they're getting, what you're getting there is you're getting a high acceleration that's some multiple of G, you know, and it's coming from the fact that any acceleration comes from your velocity vector changing. In that case, it's coming not from speeding up or slowing down, which changes your velocity vector, but from the direction of the velocity vector changing. So like if you're moving in a really tight circle, you get really high accelerations, and it doesn't come from the speed changing, it comes from the direction changing. Okay. And those are the high Gs that fighter pilots get. It comes from changing direction really quickly, more than it comes from changing speed really quickly.
Okay.
Okay, any other questions about that? I guess that's a good place to stop.